hi everyone, and I guess we are in the tough spot of being between you and some very good food, so we'll try to keep the conversation really engaging to make it worth, you know, sitting in your seats a little longer. My name is Ami. I am an intellectual property and technology attorney, and I currently work for McKinsey & Company, where I help manage and protect the company's IP portfolio and develop and enforce their brands. And I am joined by four incredibly thoughtful and smart folks, and I can give a brief introduction. Right next to me is Justin Hahn. Justin is a partner in the Technology Transactions Group of Morrison & Foerster in San Francisco, and his practice focuses on transactions and counseling involving IP and technology. Next to Justin is Wade. Wade Wallerstein is a digital anthropologist and curator who specializes in simulation and software-based artwork. He works as an associate curator at Gray Area Foundation for the Arts in San Francisco. Good West Coast representation today. Next to Wade is Karen. Karen Derricades is the head of art and culture at Creative Commons Canada, a multidisciplinary artist, a digital literacy STEAM educator, advocate for the arts and culture producers, and speaker on tech and society. And certainly last but not least, we have Carla. Carla Gannis is a transmedia artist and industry professor at NYU's Tandon School of Engineering in the Integrated Design and Media program. And so I think we can have each of the panelists give a quick little introduction, sort of their thoughts and views on what I think is an incredibly important topic. And I think kind of touches on maybe one of the sensitive points as Gen AI sort of takes a larger role sort of in our lives and work and society. And so with that, maybe I can turn it over to Justin.
Yes, I'm Justin Hahn. As already noted, I work at a large law firm, and my role, or you know, the perspective I think I'll be bringing today is that I work with a lot of companies that are both developing these AI tools and also seeking to implement them, as well as, that's sort of the overview. But I think, to give you like a snapshot of the type of work that I do, or as pertains to this, discussion, help companies like OpenAI, for example, negotiate a deal with the Associated Press to use a bunch of their archival data to access their archival data for use as training data for machine learning models, like very large language models. Now, obviously, that's one way to solve or address this kind of problem, but it doesn't necessarily scale across the entirety of the internet. The transaction costs are just too high to try to do a deal with every, you know, potential content source. So today, companies like developers of this tool, these kinds of tools are using relying on the fair use doctrine of copyright law. We can talk a little bit more about that. Also just really interested to talk a little bit about some of the other other sort of values at play here beyond merely just kind of compensation, but also things like the agency that we talked about a little bit earlier that creators desire and seek, and as well as the importance of attribution in many different communities. And then I think the final thing that I bring to the table is as a corporate lawyer, it may come as no surprise that I'm not to say they're mutually exclusive, but I am not artistically talented. And so for me, it's been really fun to use some of these generative AI tools, these image generation tools in particular, to work with my two kids who are 8 and 5, and kind of harness creativity to just come up with fantastical ideas for what kinds of images we might think of, and even if there are things that I never myself put pen to paper to create, thoroughly enjoyed sort of having that experience with them, and would love to make sure that that's something that isn't lost.
Hey guys, my name's Wade. I work at Gray Area Foundation for the Arts in San Francisco, but we operate a little bit more like a community art center. We do everything very DIY and we're very small. So in addition to running exhibitions, we also run an artist incubator. And I would say that we're like extremely confidently that 100% of the artists we're going through our incubator, going through our various education classes, are all already using these tools. Whatever they can find on the internet, whatever is available to them, it's happening. So my interest in this is really about thinking through how, rather than thinking about the future, what can we do right now? What's implementable right now at a community or like a user level? Because I will have to go back to San Francisco in a week and talk to my artists about this technology and guide them towards the right direction. So I'm thinking a lot about the onboarding of, you know, smaller organizations, educational institutions. How do we teach people about these things? And more so, how do, you know, before we, you know, and the biggest hurdle to that to me is the fact that, like, the technology is changing so fast that we on, you know, the educator side can't keep up with developments. So, you know, I'm really stuck in this place of, like, trying to think through how we can develop and think about this kind of infrastructure for artists on a larger, more structural scale. Because, you know, if we don't do something yesterday, the artists are already using this technology, they're putting their images out there, and they're being affected by it now.
I'm Karen. I work with young people and arts and culture. I advocate for arts and culture producers and with working through Creative Commons. You know, people have talked about fair use and of course, like, AI comes in and complicates these kinds of things very much. Often, you know, the terminology is misused. We need a whole new language for some of these conversations. But there are some similarities that we find ourselves in the situation of with digital rights management that, you know, was so instrumental to the inception and you know, the creation of Creative Commons. And at the time, Larry Lessig, one of the founders, you know, had said, you know, digital rights management is essentially a businessman solution to a technology issue. And I think that we are in a situation where we're missing the forest for the trees, and we're kind of in a lawyer solution environment to a much more complicated technology issue again. And for me, it's not about property and IP and these kinds of rights, but really about labor and contractual law and power, right? So at what point when creatives are negotiating their contract, you know, what is the power differential from which they are negotiating that? Could it liberate and expand income for creatives if I were to able to use my digital self and my avatar and license it out and have it doing three performances at a time? Wonderful, right? That's three times the gigs. You know, if I'm in a place of desperation where at the point where I'm signing a contract with a studio, I'm saying, you know, sure, I'll take $40,000 and give over all my rights to my voice and my avatar because maybe I could put a down payment on a home. Meanwhile, they know very well that there's millions and millions of dollars that can be earned perpetually in that. So, of course, like, how do we knowing how power works, it's kind of hard to be optimistic about where things are going, but you know, how do we set the, you know, change some of the parameters around contracts and labor and practice some new ways of being and new models and, you know, exercise some new muscles that might involve technology like smart contracts and things that can be in place of, you know, start to build the language and the practice of paying artists, you know, not only them having the ability to have and pay rent and have a normal livelihood when they're creating the work, but also to benefit from the market value or you know, residuals or whatever it is that product actually continues to create value in the world, and that they are included in receiving money from that value, you know, creation. And then in the larger picture, you know, I'm always still hoping for the larger promise of, you know, the internet and global communities and web monetization and pennies from the many, instead of, you know, hundreds of thousands or millions from collectors and wealthy patrons of the arts. So, you know, how can technology help us receive, you know, little bit of money, affordability for the audiences, for the masses, and still help creatives create.
Yeah. All right. Hi, everyone. It's really great to see you, and I'm so happy to be amongst all of these esteemed individuals. one thing I'd like AI to do is help with like nervousness when you're first and you know starting to talk on a panel. And also, I am an artist and also an educator at NYU, and I work with many avatars. So I was also thinking about ways to harness my avatars to get up here and do some of these talks. One other thing I want to kind of start this kind of my position with is a quote from Sasha Stiles, and I'm so happy she's here. I went to an event the other night that Sasha Stiles, a poet, an artist, a creative technologist, was hosting. And something she said about AI is that they are not anti-human or machine learning algorithms. They're actually hyperhuman. And so how can we harness this as artists, as educators, in a way that actually helps us grow as a culture, helps us actually think and know more about ourselves as humans. So when I'm working with my students, I teach classes like ideation and prototyping, for example. All my students, as Wade was saying, are starting to use these tools or have been using them for some time, and it actually expedites processes. And so there's so much we still don't know about ourselves, our relationship to nature, so maybe there's one like fundamental win in this is that we get time to know more of ourselves. And then in working with these emerging technologies, I've been working as an artist with emerging technologies for over 25 years, is that in working or collaborating, we are looking at resolutions or ways to solve problems from different perspectives and from more, you know, rhizomatic perspectives, perhaps. And so that's something that's really exciting to me about all of this. I think that we live in a time where it has become very popular to posit all of this through a dystopic lens. And as an educator and as an artist who fundamentally believes that, you know, my approach to all of this is thinking of it poetically, creatively, philosophically, that there are abundant possibilities here, and we have to still hold on to our optimism about what's possible. And I'll just stop there for now.
This is excellent already. And I think we've, throughout the conversation so far, we've touched on both the like opportunities, right, that AI can present in sort of enabling maybe more efficient work, sort of allowing for new things to be explored that maybe, you know, sort of weren't available before, and also some of the trepidation, right, and sort of thinking about power dynamics and other things that may just need to be thought through a little bit more carefully, I think. And so maybe to level set, though, we can just talk about sort of the different models of remuneration that exist right now. And I think, you know, Justin, you sort of alluded to these one-to-one sort of like licensing deals, but also acknowledge that maybe is not sustainable. But that is, I think, maybe one model of sort of payment that could be considered. I don't know if there's other models that are worth like just sort of putting out and having be part of the conversation that you're either seeing or that maybe you would like to see.
Well, one thing, you know, I was talking about ideation and prototyping. And for some of these low-paying tech jobs, a lot of times a lot of work is put into the ideation process. And so already, again, it's a class I teach with my students, this is a way to expedite that labor. And so again, it provides them time to maybe creatively problem solve more because they already have some tools that will generate these images at a quicker pace. And I think that that is just more efficient.
I think there's something to be said too for like the much, much larger vision of, you know, if all of the data, you know, if the AI systems are creating economic value, you know, be it problematic or otherwise in terms of the way that they're calculated in terms of GDP and such. But, you know, this kind of like liberation from labor, you know, argument, right? So if the machines can do all the work, you know, we can just sit back. Right, and then this becomes a, you know, conversation more about culture and less about artists, because of course all of us are feeding information into these data sets. But if we can create value within these economic systems from all of that information that it's being trained on, that is all, you know, arts and culture, you know, it has a massive potential not only to, you know, give us a certain kind of universal basic income, where we're basically like we're harvesting, it's harvesting our information, and we're harvesting, you know, some of the value that it's producing, but also to like massively shift, you know, economic and global inequities in terms of our relationship, you know, the dichotomy between the first and the third world, but you know, global south, in terms of who has actually been feeding a lot more information into these data systems because they can't pay for privacy. And so, you know, a lot of these systems are a lot more based on folks who are not, who can't afford the paywall and to participate in these, in, on, you know, in the internet, in the world, are paying with their information and their cultural capital. And yes, some of that, you know, certainly is like overly Western and overly simplified in terms of like, well, we'll take your story and we'll give you some, we're gonna deposit some money in your bank. Like, you know, there's a lot of cultures who are like, we don't see that way, you know, and that's not how we see ideas and property and copyright, right? We see ideas as a soup, or we don't see it as ownership, or we don't, as somebody was talking about on the last panel, or we just don't feel, we don't want to consent to that being used in that way. It doesn't feel right. That changes the space and the nature of the collaboration from which the culture was, you know, fertilized. But this is a brainstorm.
I mean, not to diverge too much from like remuneration specifically, but a concern that I hear all the time, more so than getting paid, is knowing where my images are going and what's happening to them. Or alternatively, understanding why the output of a particular imaging model has produced that output. I've heard of a number of different suggestions for ways that, you know, there could be a data breakdown showcasing some of the sources for a produced image and kind of explaining that back. And I think that, you know, in a future model, the obscurity around source is a little bit more transparent. That doesn't make sense, obscurity being transparent, but you know, that we would have a little bit more insight into what's happening behind it, because, you know, as we kind of were talking about the other day in a pre-chat, you know, remix culture is such a crucial part of our contemporary internet culture, and so I don't see that going away or anybody wanting to use AI to limit that, but I feel people are craving this kind of understanding of the delineation of these different image objects that are continuing to shape and change our culture and how we interact with or understand each other. And so I hope that in any future remuneration model that, like, I think as a baseline, we start to get a bigger picture of like how this is being made, where it's coming from, so that when we look at an image, we can maybe understand, oh, this is, you know, this looks like this because of X, and that will help us to, I don't know, use this more effectively. And or going back to the remix culture, you know, comment, I think that like as net artists, you in remix culture have demonstrated, it's not about like taking and appropriating something. Whenever artists do that, there's always like some connection to the history or to the lineage. There's a historical point being made, and I hope that, yeah, we can bring that into new contemporary models for this technology.
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing I wrestle with a bit is, when I was in law school, Creative Commons was in existence, but we met in law school actually, and she wrote a paper about the role of fan fiction and its reliance on fair use to be able to, without permission, use, you know, elements of the dominant culture, if you will, the mainstream mass media culture, and repurpose them for their own purposes, with, you know, in particular, you know, women and non-binary or gender non-conforming individuals. And I've always thought that was incredibly powerful and really felt very strongly about the use of fair use in that way, about the ability to use things without having to seek permission. And I'm often just wrestling in my own head with how to, you know, how to square that with what we have here, you know, where, you know, you've got these large language models where, you know, permission was not sought initially, in this generation of models for the most part, I think it's fair to say. There are a number of steps companies are taking to begin to respect at least an opt-out. So you see like OpenAI releasing its, that it will sort of use this GPT bot, which a user, which a website host can use its robots.txt standard to indicate that it does not want to be scraped by this bot and it will be respected. It's just the tension that I'm just flagging, because I've often struggled with the role of copyright, and I've thought that, you know, one of the few instances where it works best is when there's something like a compulsory license in the music space, for example. So if someone publishes a piece of music, I can get up on this stage, you wouldn't want this, but I could get up on this stage and play that song for you, and I think I can even record it and sell copies of that record, and I don't have to ask permission to do that. And there is a system on the back end where I'd have to pay statutory royalties to the publisher of that music. And I've thought a bit about whether, you know, how technology today isn't there to support that because these things are somewhat of a black box. It's not really possible to sort of, you can ask the chatbot, you know, show me your work, how did you do this, and it will make something up, but it's not actually, it's not actually telling you how it did that.
Mm.
But then I don't know, I think about the question of if you were to be able to develop that technology, how, you know, would that be a good thing? You know, we don't do that today in the real world, right? So if I paint in the style of someone that I've seen before, we don't, there's no mechanism by which that person automatically gets compensated. So just throwing out, again, more brainstorming session ideas, but these are the interesting tensions that I think exist in this space, and we're all looking for, I don't know, a path forward on.
I think this is, it's actually really helpful, I think, to kind of step away from just pure, like, payment or remuneration, right? I think we touched on things like consent and knowledge and sort of even being able to understand as users, right, how this technology is built, because I think that sort of ties into, I mean, just the user experience, but even as, like, a creator, well, okay, I think I've been scraped, but do I actually fit into this generated piece of content? And so I think, you know, appreciating that there's other parts that go into the conversation about payment or you know, how to sort of compensate for creation does involve sort of touching on these other elements. And, you know, Wade, I think you brought this up with your role as sort of an educator with these young artists, right, and sort of being able to maybe upskill folks. And I don't know if you would be able to touch on sort of maybe the types of things that you think should be taught, whether to your artist specifically or more broadly, but, you know, do you think there's an education piece that needs to be brought in to allow for a better conversation maybe?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that a lot of folks are using these models without having just like a basic understanding of how machine learning works in general, you know, or the way that, you know, machine learning processors are very iterative. But I also, you know, and I think that's a huge learning curve for a lot of people, and also for educators themselves. Like, I have a specialty knowledge, but, like, I have so many colleagues who are like, what the hell do I do with this? You know, they don't even know where to start, right? And, you know, because as we've seen in this card, you know, these applications have uses across just like the digital arts. There are so many different kinds of creative drafting that this technology can support and bolster. I also think that, you know, for what I'm starting to see our artists do is start to find little bits and pieces of different algorithms, different codes, different things that they can find open source online, and they're starting to patch them together and make their own models. And I think that what we're going to see is a proliferation of projects, models that we really can't totally understand what they're doing. The artists who made them don't totally understand what they're doing, and there could be all different sorts of unintended consequences. So again, going back to a baseline of like what this technology is, how it works, and empowering artists to understand and utilize these different components to, you know, build and make their own models that suit them best.
Can I just jump
in? Yes, please.
Because that's a conversation we were all having earlier, too, in terms of using these proprietary applications. Artists have been doing that for some time. I work in the XR space, and I've done lots of AR projects and VR projects using proprietary apps. And then it makes me recall the early days of like teaching HTML to students and showing them reveal source on a web page, right? And you know, that was always eye-opening to a lot of students, seeing under the hood. And I do think, one, more skilling, because there has been, at least in the arts, over the past 100 and so years, a kind of de-skilling that we've seen rise with the rise of conceptual art and the ideas. And I think that's something that we can continue to foreground, obviously, and that's very important. That's what we can kind of generate through prompts or through our data sets. But also, you know, some kind of fundamental understanding or comprehension of kind of what's going in and what to expect coming out. Also, I really am excited about these hybrid models where artists or creative technologists are kind of working with one platform and then mixing it with another and mixing it with another, which makes me think of this Jasper Johns quote, this amazing famous American artist, take something, do something else to it. And I think that that's always been an abiding principle for my own work, working as a net artist, working with remix culture, and now working with these machine learning algorithms and platforms, is to take something and then do something and do something else with it, putting it through these different filters of thoughts or applications, whether it's technological or conceptual or some kind of really great cross-pollination between the two.
And I think it's important to kind of like, you know, have more conversations to help people understand that that's what the artists that we know are doing with it. Like the stuff that's like just some straight up prompt and post of that version, like that's wonderful. That's people playing with a new tool, you know, but that is not the, like the stuff that you're seeing that is, you know, I mean, I think we also need to stop saying AI. Like, I mean, it's an absurd, you know what I mean? Like there's so many different kinds of AI. And when we're talking about how content has been affected by that and streaming and stuff, we're talking about, you know, we're already living in the algorithm, like the AI algorithm, then there's data mining, then there's GANs, then there's prompts, you know, text to, you know, and we really need to, you know, find the language that an 8-year-old or that, you know, that anybody can understand, because we need to, we cannot build and shape these things in any kind of democratic or equitable sense if we can't include many in the conversation. If we want to include many in the conversation, we need to have the language to explain to them these are nuanced things. This is not just some, you know, like some crazy dystopian, you know, weird thing that like, oh, you know, right now, you know, it's fine, but in 2 weeks we're all gonna die. Because I mean, that's what a lot of people think, right? Like, I mean, we laugh, but like that is the conversation. A lot of people say, you know, okay, like fine, you're telling me it's not that big of a deal right now, but the things I'm reading and the things I'm thinking about and the, you know, the dichotomy that they're setting up again, like artists against AI and stuff, which is super problematic. Creating all kinds of like lawsuits, like all this stuff is distractions from actually educating and then shaping it, right? And being like, okay, no, so these are all these like actual layers of things that are happening. These are all different ways of using the digital excess, right? Like we have a digital abundance. And we are now, in, you know, and that's what we've been doing for the last 20 to 30 years is, you know, filing and archiving and naming and upgrading, you know, and updating all of this digital abundance, our digital lives. And now we need to come together and really have thoughtful, inclusive conversations about what do we want to do with all this stuff, you know, other than just like ruin the planet, like putting it in a cloud, you know what I mean? Like what, like how do we, yeah.
Yeah, we should be proactive and participating.
Absolutely.
I wholeheartedly agree. And just, you know, to add a little bit of color, I think that like what the models that we're kind of talking about, like text to image, are such like early baselines. Like the artists that, you know, I see artists starting to build like what I think they call like a recursive learning model. So models that are teaching themselves, rewriting themselves and changing. It's like another, like it's a totally different kind of cognitive head shift when thinking about the model than when you have a typical image model. And I think that like we're just gonna exponentially increase in terms of degrees of illegibility and complexity over time. And so, I don't know, like within that, I don't necessarily have a great way forward, but there has to be some kind of like straight line course that we can take as we like know that these different steps are going to be coming our way.
Mm-hmm. You have to be predicting and then working backwards towards preparing for them, yeah.
I feel like I can go home and report back that I'm a pretty great dad because I've been, you know, educating my kids in this stuff, and I thought I was just sort of helping them get ready for a life of being a prompt engineer, which is what we're all supposed to be skilling up for. But one of the things I guess that they've learned is, you know, one of the tools we use has, you know, some content moderation there. And of course, if you ask an 8-year-old or a 5-year-old really what they want to draw, it, you know, usually involves a butt or a poop, and they quickly realize that that can't, or that's not permitted. And so that's an interesting discussion. I don't know that I actually fully talked that through with them in the way that I probably should have the conversation. Although one of their best outputs ever was a picture that sort of gets of the Earth farting. That went through, and it's like maybe one of them. Yeah, I'll show anyone who wants to see like that.
Well, I think touching on the idea of like participating in the conversation, I mean, I think, you know, we maybe are aware, right, like on the Senate, they're having these discussions today. They're inviting what appears to be a large, maybe not fully representative, but I think still like a large group to try to start this more formal conversation in education, right? And so I guess I would be interested to hear whether the panel has a sense of like, is law, you know, a helpful tool here? I think some other panels have talked about how that can kind of cut both ways. Whether policy, whether sort of individual company approaches maybe, and sort of self-regulation to the extent that's, you know, a way forward. But just curious to hear maybe whether, you know, law, policy, self-regulation, one or combination is maybe the way to think about this.
I mean, one thing I would jump in here is would be to give some credit to Yassine from a discussion discussion yesterday, is sort of highlighting, you know, the difference or the importance between thinking about whether things should be required by law or, you know, promoted by culture or by law.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's, I personally, you know, think that that's a great, you know, framing of things. I think if you look at a lot of these companies, for example, almost all of them that make, you know, image generation tool will respect artists' requests. I mean, in addition to now having maybe like the opt-out of not training on your data for future models, they'll also, respect an artist's request if a user says, you know, give me something in the style of blank living artist. If that living artist writes in, they can generally opt out so that that input is basically not processed by the algorithm, even if it could do so. So I think I find something like that very interesting. I think I've been thinking a lot about just the fan fiction piece, and one of the things that another one of the prior speakers, Stacy, said yesterday, which I thought was really interesting, was what would the in some ways we'd have a much less robust sort of generative AI model if it didn't take into account any of the alternative constructs proposed by some of these fan fiction works. So if a superhero was always a guy in a cape and couldn't be someone non-binary or someone other than sort of the dominant paradigm. So I guess from my perspective, I'd be concerned about law jumping in a little too early and shutting down those kinds of opportunities.
This is so random, but prior to working at Grey Area, I worked for the Consul General of Canada on technology diplomacy. So I think a lot about the policy and like the diplomacy that's involved here as like nations come together to like do negotiation with private companies over this stuff. And the fact of the matter is that like policy will never be able to keep up with the pace of the technological development. Like there's just no way. Like, if I call my colleagues back at the consulate, like they still don't know what crypto is or like how it is, you know what I mean? So it's like, that's always gonna be like 10 years behind. But at the same time, the number one thing from all of my conversations with tech companies was they all were begging for policy from the government. They're like, please legislate us, which sounds kind of weird, but they also don't want to be liable for things that happen because there was no rule and then there suddenly is a rule. And so it's a little bit like finicky in there. But at the end of the day, like, I mean, that's where I go to all of this is like, hopefully there's a policy that can, at least help to guide or shepherd or set a benchmark so that if something bad does happen, there is a protocol to follow. Because I think that the stickiest part that we get into is, an artist will get into a weird situation, something will be used, and there's no legal precedent, there's no legislation that they can use as like a foundation to take any kind of action. So even if it's not perfect, like somebody earlier, they were talking about, adjustments on either end, as we go. And to me, that feels like a really reasonable way to move forward because we don't know what the intended consequences might be. We don't know the extreme top cases of harm that might happen, but hopefully we have some kind of thing so that at least we can take action when that does happen.
Yeah, and as much as policies, it's conversations like this. I mean, this is really crucial that we are gathering and we are, as a human species, getting together and talking through these things and talking about the ethics of this, talking about diversity and inclusion, because, that's another issue that arises, as you were saying, that, okay, we want to legislate what data is being used or what images are being used, but if it's really homogeneous, that's incredibly problematic. And so in terms of education, you're right, also oftentimes policy moves in corporations and also in academia at a paleolithic pace. And so we already are grappling with the fact that, students are turning in papers using large language models. I've turned to humor, for example. I teach this class, Humor Makes Us Better Storytellers, and I have my students make avatars and work with LLMs and come up with comedy routines that they perform in metaverse space. So we can look at these things with a sense of humor, too, because we sometimes are approaching all of this and we kind of set these parameters for what the ethics are or what this is, and then there's no room for the creativity or the subversion, and oftentimes artists are really good at subverting these systems, and then we learn from that where that trajectory forward is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, you know, the conversations that we were having yesterday, there was a lot of talk about it. Interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, and having these conversations together. And it's true, it's kind of impossible. Like, the speed works so differently, right? Like, public education in terms of, like, coming up to speed, you know, even, you know, 3 years ago, pre-pandemic, like, nobody wanted to talk about, you know, I was doing search and find stuff, which now seems ancient. And they were like, this is not important, you know, they're last bastions of literature, you know, it's Dewey Decimal, and it's the librarian, and, you know, how dare you take them onto Google, and you want to make YouTube videos with them. And then, you know, 2 weeks later, March, you know, 2020, they're like, oh my God, you can teach inside a computer, come back.
The speed of which, you know, it's very hard to keep up. The problem with the other problem that compounds within tech is that not only does it move faster, but it's not inclusive, it's not representative, right? This is why we want policy, which, you know, I don't, you know, again, I think it's an impossible battle speed-wise, but the policy at least is somewhat more representative of the populace, you know what I mean? So it's like some of the policies shouldn't necessarily address how AI is used, but just how these companies, you know, like, you know, because there's just not, these companies would be asking these questions along the way if they looked different from inside, and they don't. And so then we always have to come in afterwards and say, but the people. And it's like, well, maybe if your company looked like the people a little bit more, or, you know what I mean, was more inclusive of the people, like, then even though you move at that speed, there would be people at the table that, you know, like, that there would be some kind of, like, match between that and the policy. It wouldn't seem like you're in two vacuums, you know, like, kind of yelling at each other way too late and at the wrong moment in time. And, you know, all of these are like much, much, much larger issues that are important, like, you know, consent culture. You know, they're wonderful opportunities to really dive deeper into, yeah, what it means, you know, to live in a world that's so easily shareable and so fast and so, you know, viral and duplicate, you know, like, that these ideas can grow so fast and isn't, you know, that wonderful and exciting, but that we still have so much work to do in terms of, like, ways of being with each other. And
I want to just interject, there is this VC, Scott Hartley. He wrote this book a few years ago, because I was in conversation with him on AI a few years ago, and it was called The Fuzzy and the Techie. And I love that title, and I love what the premise is. To your point, Karen, that we need these people at the table, and when I say these people, that's all of us here, right? But we need the fuzzy people too, the people who are the poets or the anthropologists or the philosophers. And I teach in an engineering school at NYU, but I teach in a department, technology, culture, and society, and one thing that sustains me being in that milieu is that I am having conversations with poets and writers and engineers and creative technologists and incredible programmers. Some of my students blow my mind, right? But we're all at the table together, whether it's on Zoom sometimes or in a metaverse space, but we're all together and having these tough conversations. Mm-hmm. And so we need the fuzzy.
No, the world needs more philosophers and absolutely and artists.
Well, I could probably ask a thousand more questions, but I want to make sure I give a few minutes to see if there's any questions from the audience. Oh, many.
So I guess I heard certain things around all this call for policy and being, like, told what to do. I was working with a large tech company on, like, responsible innovation principles, and something that somebody said stood out to me, which was standards and policy should be, like, the minimum bar, and we should seek to, you know, step above it. So I'm curious, what's maybe one step above that you would like to see for remuneration and creators that you would maybe want companies or people developing things to do?
But I'm assuming it's possible, that's just not where the energy is put, but, like, to making it more transparent, to, like, giving the context, to giving the consent. Now, people not necessarily, you know, if you're making a, you know, we're talking about this last night, if you're making a 5-second GIF, you're not going to have, you know, because I do those things, and I use images, I'm not an image maker, so I use stuff from the commons in the public domain. I'm not going to put, you know, it's not the nature of the internet and the shareable format for me to have, like, a thing that accredits that's as long as, you know, like, so it's very difficult because it's not like bibliography, you know, there's no kind of colloquial shorthand, but, you know, for
for actually practicing the consent culture that we might be able to create. But certainly the technologists, like, yeah, could we have a map? Could we see the roots? Could we see where it came from? Could we see behind the hood? Could we see how it's done? That would be nice if they would spend some time on that.
And just to build on that, I think too, like, I am always curious about who, like, wrote the models, who worked on them. Like, I'd love to see some of the labor going into building these things that are being used to be more available or public or noted, or maybe for a particular kind of, like, I don't know, but I feel like there's a little bit of attribution that is maybe even, like, outside of, like, the nitty-gritty that, like, we could do as a baseline.
That's a great idea. When I first started working with digital technologies, I studied painting for BFA and MFA, and then I moved to New York and I threw away all my paintings and began a new practice. And I remember when I first started making these works with these different programs, every time I'd make a work, I wouldn't just sign it with my name, I'd sign it with, you know, the different applications I'd use, because I was really thinking about attribution. And I was also trying to challenge this genius myth that definitely is perpetuated in the art world. I don't know if in, you know, other context, and that it's just this one sole creator who has this genius. And we all speak of, you know, the hive mind today, and thinking about the different people who are involved in our creative processes and being more transparent about it. And then something else as an educator is just thinking about, when I work with my students, I often will talk to them about creating titles for themselves that don't exist yet. And I work in the realm of speculative design. And so thinking speculatively about, you know, what is next? And it's very hard to parse that right now. It's very confusing. But having that kind of innovative thinking process to think about, well, what role could I produce for myself, and how could companies actually encourage that more? And those roles could be things that extend more into education, for example. Or now that we are collaborating with these, you know, these machine learning models, thinking about problem solving, and instead of just always kind of thinking of entertainment and that kind of quotient, what about we platform the people who are collaborating with these models and really celebrate, but also pay them for doing things for our environment and saving our planet and saving our species? Because I think the planet's going to be just fine, but what about our species and all this, you know, creativity we have amassed? And why don't we take that seriously?
Hi there. I suppose this is kind of hot off the press, so yeah, apologies if it's if you guys haven't heard about this yet, but I figured I'd ask. So I know this past week Microsoft came out, this is kind of like policy liability accountability question, so Microsoft, I think, who owns GitHub, is taking liability, or like owning all the liability for any copyright infringement for commercial clients. There's a lot of kind of like qualifiers here. And I'm wondering if you guys think that's like a good model, if you've heard about it. I think this a cynical part of me was like, are they just doing this because through GitHub they already would have been liable, or they kind of did cost benefit and it's unlikely, like there's very little copyright infringement in the output for GitHub commercial clients anyways. So anyways, I was just wondering if you guys had any thoughts about that, or if you in general thought this was like a good model. I know this is like for coding output, I think, for GitHub, but clearly this would be used, I think, for any kind of pipeline where, you know, with ChatGPT you're producing text, or with kind of image to, or text to image, artists even in school or whatever are producing images, and they might be kind of, you know, there might be copyright infringement there. So yeah,
I think I can weigh in on that one. Yes, I think you're referring to the Microsoft, is not a client of mine, so I can just speak freely. Microsoft, it's called the Copyright Compatibility Commitment, I think, and it's for Copilot, which they've labeled everything as Copilot, so it's not just for code. I think they're doing it because, this is something I've seen in the you know, business world, enterprise world, is that businesses that are risk averse are very fearful of using these tools because of the risk and the uncertainty around the copyright landscape, and whether or not this fair use of this fair use that we've been talking about will apply. There are even more caveats than you mentioned, just to be clear. So one of them is you have to enable a filter that will check, Microsoft will check the outputs that are generated by something like Copilot against the training data set, and if there's a match, it won't surface that to you, so you have to enable that. You also have to not deliberately put in an input that is that you know to, or that's like requesting infringing information, or, and then if you get an output that you know to be infringing, they also won't indemnify you for that. And then on top of all that, and the full policy hasn't been released yet. I understand it goes live October 1st, but it's just weird I've memorized all this. I'm not shilling for this at all, but I've been advising on it. What's the final piece? Oh, it's just, it may be subject to some sort of dollar liability cap. So if you get all that up to $500, that's not very helpful. It may be more likely, you know, the cost of the services you've procured from them. But I think they're really doing it just because of a commercial necessity, because people are, they're incredibly powerful tools. But there's just an incredible amount of fear, uncertainty, and doubt about that, and so they're trying to clarify it.
Firstly, thank you for an insightful discussion. So misinformation and disinformation, even without AI, has been a huge issue, and AI only serves to amplify it. And the advancement of AI is going to hyper-amplify it. So we all know, you know, the more you say something, it becomes the truth. And I don't know if I said it right, but but as it relates to art, it becomes very easy to replicate things. You could, like one of the panelists discussed, you could pretty much say, generate a sunrise in the style of Leonardo da Vinci, and you got one. And then you could replicate that by basically reading the art and converting it into text and then regenerating it into another image. And nobody owns the copyright for any of this stuff. So in general, how do you deal with misinformation, disinformation, and specifically about art? Can you even regulate it? How do you even go about grappling how you even regulate something of this nature?
Well, one thing, art sometimes playfully deals with misinformation. And let me explain that. In terms of art, oftentimes we see several movements beginning with Dada, you know, at the turn of the 20th century or the beginning of the 20th century, and these artists didn't know how to really parse what was going on in the world. It was our first world war. And so they turned to the absurd, and they turned to kind of misinformation in the sense, not in something that was nefarious, but in terms of looking at the world from a different lens. So sometimes there can be ways to harness that for us to wake up, and instead of always seeing the reality we have all co-constructed in one particular kind of point of view or in one frame of reference, to look at it from a different angle. So sometimes these things, if done in such a way that it is to kind of open up our eyes to new perspectives, I think that that can be really exciting, and that often happens in the domain of the arts. But in terms of how we can regulate disinformation campaigns that like affect elections, that stuff gets scarier, of course, and we've seen that, you know, happening across social media platforms for several years now. But one thing I will point out is that, you know, in the early ages of photography and film, you know, there's this anecdote about people being in a theater and the train is coming towards them. That was a black and white, grainy piece of film, but they thought that was reality. And one thing we have the capacity to do is we would look at that today and we would know that wasn't real. And I think we have a canny sensibility to start to learn and detect, or at least I'm hoping that, and we will be able to detect more easily than we do now when we see something that is fake or untrue. Maybe, yeah. I'm overly optimistic.
Well, again, yeah, media literacy, digital literacy now, you know, because again, and this is so often, I mean, people over 65 are more likely to share fake news and stuff. You know, my mother's been worried lately that Elon Musk is trying to get her to do some job thing online. And then I think because of the Internet of Things, my phone is now sending me the videos that she's been seeing, and they're so much more absurd than I thought. Like, there's very obviously deep fakes, and I don't know if it's because I'm in the business of media literacy or what exactly it is. She's aware that the reality of a deepfake exists, but doesn't seem to see that it's like, it's not synced properly, it's not seamed properly. But again, yes, of course, these things become better and better and more difficult to detect, but they are, we can also get better and better at understanding, and again, it's all about transparency, like understanding how these systems work, understanding how these media are constructs, so that we can be able to distinguish it. Now, I don't know if you were talking about in terms of like provenance of like actual artwork, of like how do you know if it's the real Van Gogh, and you know,
yeah.
like if that's what was the question more. I don't know. I'm not sure.
Generations later.
Future generations not knowing the real versus the.
Oh, I can speak to that a little bit. I mean,
a profound question.
We actually have a couple of ways of dealing with that. In the traditional art world, we write a paper contract that accompanies the work of art. There are special stamps, seals, physical marks. We do things to make sure that the paintings or the prints or whatever they are authenticated as such. But now, folks like Muriel Quancard, who's one, is working with the blockchain to do different kinds of verification and provenance and authenticity tracking. So now, even like forget NFT sales or like crypto market, we're using different kinds of methods for creating like provenance tokens and authenticity tokens that are attached to physical objects or to digital assets. And so, I mean, they're imperfect, and there's ways around different systems, but. There are a lot of folks, particularly in the museological like authentication space, that are actively using these new technologies to further those ends. And I also assume that, I mean, again, also not a technologist here, but I assume that if there are technologies that are good enough to determine those fakes, there are also going to be technologies that are good enough to read those as fake too. So I'm hoping that that in addition to the tools of deception, we also have the tools of detecting that are at pace.
I think ideally, you know, responsible tool makers might build some of that functionality in terms of watermarking that might not be perceptible to the human eye or might not be, you know, audible to the human ear, but is there nonetheless.
Have you ever tried to open a locked PDF from Adobe Acrobat? Yeah, it's not happening.
So the technology exists.
Authenticity and authentication, like metadata scan.
Right.
Well, I think with that, we are probably ready for lunch, and so I want to thank the panelists for an incredibly illuminating